let's all stand and let's worship the Lord tonight.
Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Lift up your voice to God. Pray in the spirit and with understanding. Magnify the Lord. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Lift up your voice to God. Pray in the spirit and with understanding. The Lamb of Calvary, for His grace so rich and free, magnify the Lord with me, magnify the Lord with me, bless the Lamb of Calvary, Jesus gives us liberty.
To magnify the Lord tonight. He is worthy of all the praise. Lord, we thank you today for your love. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. Lord, you have been so good to us. And Lord, we welcome you into this place tonight, Lord, to fill us with your love, to fill us with your spirit. Lord, through this time of worship, through the study of your word, Lord, we pray that it'll all be done to bring glory and honor to your name. Touch us, we pray tonight in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? He is worthy. Just remain standing as we continue to worship tonight as Brother Coy comes to lead us right now.
Praise God. Page 329. Standing on the promises I now can see. Perfect present cleansing in the blood for me. Standing in the liberty where Christ makes free. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on of God. Praise God. Every promise.
promise in the book is mine. It's another old song. Every chapter, every verse, every line. Do you believe that this evening? Well, folks, as long as we hold to His hand, if we stay close enough to Him to hold to His hand, I know that we're going to make it. Let's sing it. Page 358, if you got a book there.
Turn. I don't know who picked out the songs tonight, but read my mail. Okay, I'll get it together here in a minute. It excites me every time that God shows up and surprises you. I hope I never get to a point that I take that for granted, because as you go through life and these things happen and little things that God does for you, wow. I just think I'm one person out of this whole universe, and you're one person out of this whole universe, yet God loves us enough to give us special treatment, each and every one of us. So anyway, told somebody, I don't know who it was, that I think it was Pastor, I said, this message was for Sunday. A week from Sunday. Yeah. And I said, what? First part of the week, God started really just hitting me with it. And I don't know. I had written down some scripture and put them in my pickup. Because a lot of times I get to out by myself and I'm waiting on something or someone or something like that, and I'll study and look at things and read and in the quiet of the day. And the scripture was on the floor of my pickup. And I picked them up, and I thought, oh, well, I better put them up, because that's what I'd written down for that Sunday. And I looked at it, and I looked at the verses, and I put it back up in the overhead deal of my truck, and I could not forget it. So I just kept on and kept on looking and this and that. And anyway, long story short, or short story long, then we get here tonight, and I was still kind of didn't know, but I get here tonight and you guys sing those songs, and I'm like, okay, Lord. But anyway, in life, the title of tonight's message is, and it's out of the book of Lamentations, and I'm going to have a lot more scripture than what I'm going to actually read, but the one that I'm going to read is Lamentations chapter 3, starting in verse 22, and it says, it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. And I got to stop right there. This ain't how I was going to do it. I'll just tell you that right now. But his compassions fail not. He cares enough about us that they're not going to fail. And the title of the message is, I will not be consumed. I will not be consumed. But it's by the Lord's mercy that we're not consumed. The first part of that chapter, and I'm going to let y'all read that on your own, it talks about how the paths are crooked. It talks about how things are happening and life is going on and all these things are happening in their life that they're not comfortable with. And I can't help but think we've dealt with a lot of things with my family, my mom and dad, and different things that are hard, you know? And then as a preacher and as a pastor, I get the opportunity to hear a lot of things that from different people, and they're asking for prayer and they're asking for help from the Lord, and life is not easy. And I look around and I see people that are godly people and they're following God, and everything's busting loose in their life. And I wonder about it, and I wonder, you know, well, why and why and why? And little things, even little things in our own lives, like, in, you know, I've had a cold since Sunday. I got up, or Saturday night, I guess, on the way home, I started having the sniffles, and I thought it was allergies, and I still think it was. Carla don't, but she's not a doctor. But anyway, and I started feeling worse and worse and worse, and I wasn't sleeping any, and I said, Lord, I've got to have some help. You know, oh, we got all these things going on. I'm trying to get this done so that I can get this done, so that I can, y'all with me? I don't have time to be sick. And anybody ever kind of whine in your prayers? Now, y'all don't leave me out here on the island by myself, because I do sometimes. I said, Lord, you know, I'm trying to do all these things for you. I'm trying to be who I need to be, and I'm not real good at it sometimes, and I need your help. But then it seemed like that was yesterday morning, and yesterday afternoon I was sicker than ever. I said, Lord, you know that I need to get all this stuff caught up. Lord, you know that I need to get to this point. Lord, you know that I need to be of sound mind. And Lord, you know that my pastor's leaving and he's kind of depending on us. And I let it go. God wants us to be the best we can be. But yet he did not promise us that we wouldn't have to get through some crooked roads. He has not promised us that we wouldn't have to fight the enemy. And that's what we're doing. You know, I hear doctors' reports and all kinds of things that just blow your mind. But God comes through. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. And verse 23 says, they are new every morning, and great is thy faithfulness. And then it goes on and it 24, and it says, the Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Are we holding on to God's unchanging hand? Yeah, we better be. Are we? But sometimes I get consumed. I allow myself to get consumed by the devil and all the little things that he throws our way, all the things that we think are a big deal, and all the things that we think are going to just be the end. But yet, my hope is in him. And then verse number 25 says this, the Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. When I'm reading this, I'm thinking, how many people, and I've heard it preached before, but how many people give up just minutes before the breakthrough? How many times have I let something completely wreck my spiritual walk with God? That if I'd have just held on a little bit more, a little bit longer, just a minute or two more. How many times have I failed that test, but just by a point? Good unto them that wait for him. I was thinking about what Pastor says a lot of times in the altar service, to tarry and wait for the answer from God. To tarry just a little longer. To wait on him. And then I look at it from a different angle. And I'm one of those people that, you know, sometimes the Lord don't answer my prayers fast enough to suit me. And sometimes I would really like to help him ahead of time. Sometimes I'm like, Lord, you know, I know you hadn't told me this, but if you'll let me, I'll go talk to that person. And the Holy Spirit says, whoop, be quiet. And sometimes I'll say, Lord, that person's not going to listen to what I have to say. One of the biggest faith builders for me recently was when we started praying for our prodigals. And I've told him this, so I guess it's okay to tell everybody. I told him, I said, you know what? I started praying for you that you'd be saved and find God. And I said, me and you go way back. And I've always loved you. You know that. But I said, I'm going to tell you right now, I started praying with very little faith. Because I really didn't see how in the world that you'd ever be able to come to God. He said, you thought I was that bad? I said, no, I just knew the situation. You know, you're off somewhere else. You don't have the opportunity to get in a church. You don't have the opportunity to be ministered to every day. You know, and all. And I said, there was just a list of things that stacked up. But I just felt like I needed to keep praying. You know? And this church was praying. Wow. That has been a faith builder to me, because I didn't see how. I didn't know how. I had tried everything I knew to try. So I went back to the thing that I hate to hear people say, and it is, well, all we can do now is pray. Boy, that's a pet peeve of mine. Well, that's the best thing we can do. Let's get going at it ahead of time. But he's good to them that wait for him. To the soul that seeketh him. I've got some cows missing. That I can't find. They're on the ranch somewhere. Y'all probably thinking, well, this guy ain't taking very good care of stuff. Well, I guess I'm not. But I've got a bunch missing. Not a bunch. Two or three. But every time that I get a few extra minutes, you know what I do? I go look for them the last place I saw them. I'll get caught up a little bit and I'll go look for him. Coy's been there. He knows there's some pretty good woods and kind of like in the jungle in a place or two, high grass. But I look for him, search for him. And it's a slow process, because if you get in a big hurry, you'll drive right by one or ride right by one, and it'll be over there 10 foot away from you, and you'll miss it. Same way when you're deer hunting. But here's what I want to share with you about that. The soul that seeketh him, that we're willing to take the time, that we're willing to put in the work, that we're willing to look hard for God. We're willing to look for what he wants in our life. We're willing to put in the time and listen and look in the woods, if you will, to figure out what he wants from us. And that's one of the promises. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him. To the soul that seeketh him. You know, I look back some on my life and I think, what a blessing it was to be in a jam from time to time. You say, well, preacher, that's the silliest thing I ever heard. Who likes that? I didn't say I like it. But I'm thankful that I've been there where I learned to seek him. I'm thankful that there everything hadn't been just a bed of roses, that I had to depend on God, or I chose to depend on God. Let me change the way you say that. I didn't have to, but I chose to. And I found him faithful. Today, I was thinking about a lot of things. I was busy and thinking about a lot of different things. And then when got to visit with Cody this afternoon, and when I did, I was reminiscing on things from the past and things that God has done for me personally. And then I was thinking about a lot of things that God has done for a lot of people I know, because he's faithful. He's willing to do that. And then verse number 26 says this: it is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. When you're looking at that, at hope and quietly wait, that's the words that jump out to me. I guess because I have so little patience. But it's real easy for me to get consumed with the things of the world. And I don't think I'm alone at that. It's real easy for a lot of us to get caught up in the things of the world. And as we're caught up in the things of the world, it don't necessarily have to even be bad things. I get caught up in things and get way more stuff going on than I need to do sometimes. and I get caught up in life, and I get caught up in other people's lives. And you get asked to do 1,000 different things, and you're asked to be 1,000 different things for your family, for whoever, your neighbor, or whatever. To the point that if I'm not careful, I'm too busy for the things of God. Where do we wait quietly on the Lord? How do we wait quietly on the Lord? How can I get myself to a point that He's first and foremost in everything I do? I was thinking today about my dad, and I'm going to share this story, and I'm going to go on. But he's had me in church all my life. When I was out of church as a young adult, being goofy, he never failed to call me on Sunday and ask me if I went to church. Now, is church going to get me to heaven? I believe it's going to be a part of it. My salvation is going to get me to heaven. But he was smart enough to know that if I wasn't in church, I wasn't going to stay where I needed to be. And he'd call me and he'd ask me, did you go to church today? Well, no, Dad, I didn't. I had this going on and that going on. And he'd say, and I can just hear it. It gives me cold chills. He'd say, huh. That's all he'd say. Huh. But a few years ago, he told me, he said, if I could give you one thing in life, it would be that you wouldn't wait until you were old like me to put your whole faith and trust in God. I said, well, I thought you did. He said, no. No, he said, I didn't. But he said, when I got to the point that I depended on God for every little thing, when I got to the point that I realized that whatever happened, God had my back. When I got to the point that I realized that had to be first in everything I did, and that I was put on this earth to reach other people for the kingdom of God, he said, that's when I had peace in my life. So I said all that to say this: quietly wait. Quietly wait. Wait on God. Because so many times through the years, some of you are quite a bit older than me, I found out today. Not going to call any names, but anyway, I didn't realize that much difference. But here's what I'm saying with that. You know, God wants to use every one of us. He wants every one of us to be faithful to Him. He wants us to be doing what He's called us to do. He wants us to be that person that He put us on earth to be. And I've seen so many people come in church and get on fire for God and start reaching others for the kingdom of God. and something happens in their life. Just something from the world hits them. Some of them it's sickness. Some of them it's a death in the family. Some of them it's, I don't know, you fill in the blank. But I've seen this happen over and over again. Things like that happen, and it does one of two things. It either draws you closer to God, or they run away. There's a song an old cowboy friend of mine sings, and it's on YouTube. You can look it up. I'm not going to try to sing it and butcher it. But his name is Monk Skelton, and the name of the song is Wolves. And he's a pastor, and he sings that song. And I listen to it once in a while because it encourages me to be what God's called me to be. And it's kind of an old cowboy song, and it talks about the wolves pulling heifers down. And I'm not saying y'all are a bunch of heifers, okay? But here's the thing. He sings that song, and it talks about that he's getting them in before the wolves pull them down, drag them down. And then at the end of the song, it says this. It says, Lord, keep me from being one that the wolves pull down. But it's by his mercies that we're not consumed. We have to make up our mind which side of that coin we're going to be on. Am I going to be one that when something happens bad and there are a few things go wrong in your life, that I'm going to go the other way? Or am I going to be one that says, okay, Lord, I'm going on with you and I'm not going to be consumed? We talked about a lady before service, and you didn't know that was a God thing. But we talked about a lady that had lost children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and held her faith. Sister Verda said, she's a strong woman. She was. But she was a godly woman that put her faith and trust in God, and it had a made up mind, no matter what, I'm not going to be consumed, but I'm going to put my faith and trust in God Almighty, and he's going to bring me through. And that's what these scriptures tell me, that if I will hold of that unchanging hand, he's going to bring us through. And I was thinking today, and of course you think a lot more about when there's a death or something of that nature, but those folks will be fine, the Christians. The non-Christians are going to have a tough time. What do they have to hold on to? Well, I'm going to go a little further than that. It's our duty to show them what they can hold on to. If they'll just get a hold of God's unchanging hand, things will change for them. And the other scripture that I want to read that I didn't tell Pastor is Lamentations 2 and 19. It says, arise, cry out in the night. In the beginning of the watches, pour out thine heart like water before the face of the Lord. Lift up thy hands toward him for the life of the young children that faint for hunger in the top of every street. It's my duty to stand in the gap. It's my duty to be the person that's willing to hold my hands up and worship God. It's my duty to cry out before the Lord. And then it says, cry out for the young children. He found it pretty quick, didn't he? Cry out for the young children. And I thought, unsaved people. Maybe people that don't know any better. Maybe people that do know better, but they're not willing to turn. We got to stand in the gap for, we have to be the ones that are going to be praying for those. Praying for the prodigals. Praying for people that may be a little weak. Praying for the community. Praying for children that don't even know what a church is all about. Even adult people. I was preaching a message one time, and God showed me something through an individual that individual had no clue what a big deal it was to me. And I was preaching, and I said, and I said, like in the story of David when he killed Goliath. And I said, and everybody knows that story. You know, I didn't even read the scripture. Never thought about it again, and went all the way to the end of the message, had the altar call. And there was two people saved that morning. But the thing that sticks out to me is there was a young man that, after the service was over, walked up and he said, Brother Kenny, where is that story about David and Goliath in the Bible? And I'm terrible. I couldn't bring it up just off the cuff like that. I said, I'll find it and tell you. And he said, you said everybody knows that story, and I didn't. I've never read that. That was a grown man. People are looking for what God has for them, but they're also looking for us to help them and take them to where they need to go. We have such a calling on our life that we don't, sometimes we take for granted. We'll say that again. We have such a calling on our life that sometimes we take it for granted. What we can do for the kingdom of God, we think, well, I'm not going to make a difference. Oh, yes, you are. If you're willing to take that one more step and step out and listen to what God tells you to do. Tonight, we've got a few minutes left, and I'm going to ask that we pray and we ask God to reveal to us the things that we need to be doing, and also that we ask Him, Lord, give me the strength not to be consumed. I ask for a hedge of protection over me, that we won't be consumed because people's eternity is at stake. People's eternity is at stake. By the words we give them, by the things that we say to them, by the way, here's a big one, by the way we act in front of them, by the love we show. by all the things that we go through life and allow ourselves to be consumed with life. And the scope of things, that person that cuts me off in Fort Smith in the car, their eternity is a lot more important than them aggravating me. Or that person that's rude to you at the grocery store, they say they're really bad at Walmart. That's what they say. I don't know. But they're looking at us. Am I showing Jesus to the people I come in contact with? Let's all pray together.
Cross where thou hast died.
is our prayer tonight. God, that you would draw us nearer to you, Jesus. God, that you would strengthen us, Lord. Empower us with your spirit, God, to be a vessel that you can use to build your kingdom. And Lord, I pray that tonight that you would go with us, Lord, that you would lead, guide, and direct in all that we do. God, that our lives may be lived, God, to bring glory and honor to your name. And Lord, we give you praise and we bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. One more time, can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? He is worthy. Don't forget service on Sunday. Be here Sunday morning, Sunday school at 9:30, worship at 10:40. God bless you. We'll see you then.